give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Ladies and gentlemen, fellow Christians and friends, you are tuned to the Hope Covenant Kingdom Fellowship, Hour of Virtue Worship and Holy Communion. We come to you each and every Sunday at 3 o'clock p.m. Central Standard Time, D-Body. If you're enjoying this hour of worship experience, why don't you let us know by phoning us at area code 773-924-2790. Our scripture reading, 1 Corinthians 11 chapter, beginning at the 23rd verse. For I have received of the Lord. Okay. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye drink this, eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of this bread and drink of this cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause, many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. And the word of God is already blessed, that God be glorified, Satan be horrified, and the word be edified. Let us pray. Most holy and righteous Father, the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we come once more and again on another first Sunday in the year of 2021. And we come to you as humble as we know how, lifting up holy hands, humbling our spirits in your presence, Lord. And so, Father, we don't bow because we've been so good, because holy we have not been. So we bow just to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. We lift you up. We praise your name because you are the beginning and the ending, the first, the last, the Alpha, the Omega, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Rapha, and Jehovah Elohim. You are God all by yourself, slow to anger and quick to mercy. And Father, you allowed our golden moments to roll on a little while longer, wherever we are glad. Now, Father, we ask that you would allow your spirit to rest on us during this hour of worship experience, that yokes be destroyed, strongholds brought down, deliverance go forth, and somebody come crying, what must I do to be saved? You said you would not let your word come back void, but accomplish those things that it set out to do. So we lean, trust, and depend on you. For Master, we know that you rule and super rule. Now, Father in heaven, hide us behind the altar in yonder's glory. In any way you bless us, we'll be satisfied. Father, we ask that you look on the sick, look on the bereaved, look on the shed in, as far as our voice can be heard, Father. And then we bind and rebuke Satan on every hand and cancel every assignment of the enemy. And Father, we ask that you would protect us, that you would shield us, and that you would keep us only as you can do it, Father. Now, Father, we ask that you would cover us and shield us with the blood of your Son, Jesus. Let us down in the treasure of your love. And then give us a word for your people. That you be glorified, we pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Good afternoon, and good evening. Amen. We are so very happy again to share with each and every one of you all on another first Sunday in this new year. Amen. God is moving by his Spirit. Amen. And so we are so very grateful to share with you, because it's just one more time, the Lord have allowed us together one more time. And he didn't have to do it, but he did. Millions and thousands have gone on, but by his mercy, grace, and favor, he have allowed us the opportunity that we now enjoy. Amen. So Jesus said on the other day, he said, for if these hold their peace, he said, the rocks will cry out. And I don't need no rock to cry out for me. So every time I get a chance to praise him, I will. So we just lift up holy hands. We praise God's name because he is worthy. Amen. He is a good God. He is a mighty God. He just is God anyway. We thank him for his Son, Jesus, that gave his life, that we might have a right to the tree of life. God bless you, all of you that have tuned in, wherever you might be on this evening, in your various homes, your place of business, on your job, driving along in your cars, your place of confinement, wherever you were kind enough to tune us in at this 3 o'clock hour. Thanks be unto God that giveth us the victory through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. Trust in the Lord, lean not to thine own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. I'm glad for this opportunity to visit again with you. Amen. To tell you that I am on the Lord's side. Amen. And so we just happy this evening, this afternoon, and we for this celebration, for this hour of worship. And so we ask that you would just take time to share on your Facebook timeline, and we invite you to subscribe to Dr. Michael Body, our YouTube channel. Amen. So happy to see my cousin, Lenora Thompson. Amen. Praying for that family. Praying for my cousin Eddie, and God bless Evangelist Monica Body and all who have tuned in on today. Again, we are praying for our family. Amen. For the Hawthorne and Saeed family in the transitioning of my nephew, Adam Saeed, who will be funeralized on Tuesday. And we are praying for our family, and we solicit your prayers, beloved. I want to thank everybody for your condolences and for every expression of love you've shown during this time. Also, I'm also thanking those of you who have been keeping my sister Rita Humes lifted up in prayer. All my sisters, Monica, and all my brothers, my children, we all need prayer. Amen. We living in a mean world, in a wicked world. So we all need prayer. My cousins, my auntie, amen, in John Stroger Hospital. Let us keep her lifted up, that God's will be done, amen, in our lives. Amen. And I come to tell you that he can do anything but fail. And I say he can fail if he wanna. Amen. So again, we are continuing to solicit your prayers for every church that's open. We are praying for every leader, every pastor of every church, because the enemy is attacking on every hand. Amen. And so the Bible instructs us to put on the whole armor that we can stand in this last and evil day. So pray for your pastor. Pray for your church. Amen. Pray for all pastors. Pray for all churches. Pray for your neighborhood. Pray for your community. Pray for the schools in your community. Amen. Pray for self, for safe passage as your family members and children and grandchildren go to and fro in this city, that God would protect and cover and shield them. Amen. All right. And so we are very happy to share with you again. This is the first Sunday, and we do observe Holy Communion. And we ask that you will prepare by having your cracker and your grape juice and or fruit juice. If you don't have any juice that you want to, or water if necessary, bread, or even cookie, if that's what you got. We want to commune together. And so now we're going to go into our message for today. Amen. We're going to go into our message for today. And we invite you to the gospel recorded by St. Matthew. The gospel recorded by St. Matthew. The 16th verse, and it says in this familiar passage of Scripture, "And Simon Peter answered and said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon bar Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father in heaven. And then he says, And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." And we're going to go to Ephesians, amen, second chapter of Ephesians 19 and 20. And it reads, "Now therefore ye are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone." Our thought for today, the apostolic church. Amen. We solicit your prayer that God would use us as his instrument. talking today about the Apostolic Church. And when we speak of the Apostolic Church, we are speaking of the apostolic teachings of the church and not necessarily a apostolic denomination, because denominations are not scriptorial. Amen. Whatever the sign on the door is, if it's a Catholic church, if it says Baptist church, if it says Lutheran or Methodist, that's just the name of the church. When you learn better, you do better. In the Bible, there is only one church. There have only ever been one church. When Jesus said, upon this rock, I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So there's only one church, many members, but one body. So that would make denominations and denominational beliefs not biblical. And as we grow and as we learn, we begin to understand that God never planned for the church to be divided. And when we divide the church into denominations, then we become divided. And in this day and time, Lenora, if we ever needed to be together as one, we need to be able to do it now. So the church is not an organization. A lot of us think the church. I talk to folks and they tell me the church is a business. There is business that has to be taken care of. But for those of you that think the church is a business, I must bust your bubble, because the church is not a building, nor is it an organization. Now, the church is organizational. There are some things we have to do according to Caesar, I put it that way. But the church is an organism. The church is an organism. And the fact that the church is a body made up living members, amen, shows that it is not an organization. Well, what you're saying here, body, the church is an organism. An organization is made up of distinct units of a building, distinct units that may be removed and replaced by new parts without destroying the integrity of the building. But a human body is an organism, and the church is many members of what? A human body. So you cannot remove an eye or an ear or an arm or a foot or even a fingernail or tooth without destroying, amen, the integrity of the body and causing its mutilation. So we see from this that Christ, to lose just one member of his body, the church, is to mutilate the church. The church is apostolic. Amen. Where you going, body? Matter if it's Baptist, or as I said before, whatever the denomination, whatever the name of the church, but according to the New Testament church and the scripture, the church is apostolic in three ways. The church was built on the foundation of what? The apostles. The church preserves and hands on the apostles' teaching with the Holy Spirit's help. So the teaching of the New Testament church came through the hand of the apostles. And the church continues to be taught. It continues to be made holy and led by the apostles through their successors. Amen. And that's what we refer to as apostolic succession, which are bishops in union with the fivefold ministry. Amen. The word apostle means, simple as this, one who is sent. We get hung up on those names and confused and judgmental, but apostle merely means one who is sent out in the New Testament. There are two primary uses of the word apostle. Number one, apostle is the firstly is the specifically referring to the 12 apostles of Jesus Christ. And some people would say, well, only apostles that they have ever been were those 12. But then there is the second, which is the generically referring to others, including myself, who are sent out to be messengers and ambassadors for Jesus Christ. Now, Paul, that was so many years ago, so there's no way in the world that Paul can come and minister as an apostle in 2021. So an apostle is one who has a call to plant, to oversee churches, various different gifts. His verifiable church plants and spiritual sons in the ministry, and sons meaning sons and daughters, amen. When the Bible says man, it does not mean physically, and nor does it divide man and woman. When it says man, it speaks of humanity. So man, when it says man, woman is included. So who is recognized by other apostles, and meets the biblical qualifications. Amen. In the book of Ephesians, it said, and he gave some apostles, this is Bible, and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, the work of the ministry, and the edifying of the body of Christ. And then it goes on to say, until we all come together in a unity of the faith. Amen. And so this generation of apostles, we have a job to do. Why? Because the church have not come back into the unity of the faith, a perfect church. Many people, they try to fit the church of God into a mold that they think is best suited for the church. In other words, what they try to do is to force the church into a function that they think that it will fit within their framework. The framework that they have established. In other words, the one size fits all pattern does not work for the church. Why? Because there are many members, but one body. And a lot of us get confused, Lenora, because this church worships in this style, traditionally. That one worships this way. So we call them Baptists because they baptize. We call them apostles because they believe in baptizing in Jesus' name. So we have just found a way and asked black people, one thing we should never do is divide. How can you divide one? He said, on my church, on my rock, on this rock, I build my church, excuse me. He said nothing about another church. You will not find in the scripture a verse about any denomination. It don't say nothing about no Catholic church. Is the Catholic church wrong? No. Catholic is a tradition of a certain type of worship. Same way the Baptist is a tradition. But when it comes to denomination, there is, well, what is your belief? Are you either saved or you a sinner? Amen. You either saved or a sinner. It's either holiness or hell. So the church is not just an organization, but the church is an organism. The New Testament church met in homes. Some of them met in temples. And the work and worship of the church was not confined to a structured service or confined to a certain building. Philip, amen, he preached in the desert. And so today we getting all miscombobulated because of pandemic and COVID-19 and whether we should worship virtually, whether we should worship in the building. The building is just a building that houses the church. We are the church. So whether you in the building at this time when it's most conducive, amen, for you to be in your home or virtually or if you feel comfortable. But the building is not the church. Amen. Paul preached to the Jews in the synagogue. But also, guess what? He also preached in the marketplace. Amen. So neither intimidation or persecution was able to destroy the church. Jesus said, the very gates of hell shall not, what? Prevail against it. Yes, the church did not compromise itself to political views of powers. What are you talking about, body? The church did not come in agreement if God said that it was abomination. It was abomination. Now we compromise. Same-sex marriage. But what did God mean when he said, for this cause, he turned them over to uncleanness and to a reprobated mind. So there is no compromise in the true church to our political views. We marching and talking about, what's that thing? Is that the rainbow? Whatever. Y'all know what I'm trying to go, where I'm trying to go. Pride, and then call it pride. That's what I'm talking about, pride. And that pride we ought to be ashamed of. I said it. Why? Because those people in that particular community of people, and I'm not trying to knock them because they have to stand before God for themselves. But taking God's rainbow that was a symbolic of no more water but fire next time and using that to symbolize abomination. Politically, they think it's all right. But it said, political views or powers, nor kings, nor were governors able to stop the growth or hinder the influence that the church has. And it still shouldn't be able to do it now. The Bible says in Matthew 16 and 18, not even the very gates of hell shall prevail against the church. And leading the way of these brand new groups of believers was a small group of men. And who were they called? They were called the apostles. From a new converts class commissioner of Christ endowed, see what I'm saying, with miraculous powers. That's what you would get when you speak up apostles in a new converts class, commissioner of Christ, endowed with miraculous powers. So the 12 disciples of Jesus fit this definition of apostle. So as we study today about the apostolic church, let us look at the office, amen, because the gift of an apostle is an office. Look at Matthew 10th chapter. We see the commissioning of the 12 apostles. We're going to start at Matthew 10 and 1. And it says that, and when he had called unto him his 12 what? Disciples, he gave them what? Power. That was those apostles back there against what? Unclean spirits, to cast them out, and to heal all manner of sickness and a manner of disease. When he sent them out, he didn't just send them out to say I'm an apostle, but he sent them out with an assignment, with an office. Verse 2, now the names of the 12 apostles are these. The first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip, and Bartholomew, Thomas, and Matthew, the publican, James, amen, the son of Alphaeus, and Lebbaeus, whose surname was Thaddeus. So, fourth verse, Simon the Canaanite, Judas Iscariot, which I'm sure you are familiar with, who also betrayed Jesus Christ. As Jesus prepared to send them out, he gave them clear instructions. And that's something a lot of us can't do. We can't follow instructions. But he gave them clear instructions regarding the message and the people for whom the message was for. Amen. Let's go to the fifth verse. These 12 Jesus sent forth, and he's still sending them today, and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans, enter ye not. Those were his instructions. Verse 6, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Verse 7, and as ye go, preach, saying, what? The kingdom of heaven is at hand. That ought to be your message. Amen. So these were true apostles. Why? They were first called out. They were sent forth with specific orders. Not only did Jesus commission them to deliver this message of hope to the nation of Israel, but used them to establish, amen, the foundation on which Jesus Christ would build his church. Let's look at Ephesians 2 and 19. Now therefore ye are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Verse 20, and are built upon the foundation of the apostle and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being what? The chief cornerstone. Amen. I love the Bible. I love God's word. 21, in whom all the building fitly framed together. Amen. Grow it unto a holy temple in the Lord. So God continues to use men. Did y'all hear the word? He continues to use men and women. God didn't just stop back then, but he uses men and women today to go forth and declare this message of the salvation and hope that was first delivered to us by those apostles. The method may change, but the message is forever settled. Amen. And if we change the message, then we endanger ourselves. We endanger ourselves when we change God's message. Look at Galatians 1 and 8. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel, and that's what's going on now. We preaching all kind of stuff. Entertainment, to prosperity. And it's nothing wrong with preaching a lot of things we preach, but we leave Jesus out. And the gospel is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when you preach and leave Jesus out, you're not preaching the gospel. So it said, but though we or any angel in heaven preach any other gospel unto you than which have been purchased unto you, let him be what? Accursed. Galatians 1:9. As we said before, so I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you, can change the method, but don't change what? Change the method. We don't have to do it the same, but we need to have the same message. Hallelujah. I like that. With the church being established and the word of God being delivered, the work of the apostles, watch this, the work of the apostles then was completed. Okay, body, where we go from here? But however, our work has not yet finished. God had a plan for his church to reach every person with the gospel message. Jesus himself made it clear that he was sending all of his disciples with a message. Jesus said before he sent it into the heaven in Acts, y'all got Bibles, 1:8. He said, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and into Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Verse 1:9, Acts. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. The task, beloved, must be completed. We can't give up. When Jesus starts a work in you, Jesus is able to finish it. What Jesus starts, he will complete. Jesus believes in completeness. God does not expect us to establish his church for the purpose of showing what we have in our power, and that's what we're doing now. We're establishing our own church, our own kingdom. Cause in our power, we couldn't build the church. Why? Because Jesus already had it built. When he said to Peter, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I build my church. So if your church is not God's church, it is not the church. Nor does he expect us to establish it today. Amen. He does not us to establish it solely, amen, for the use of our own intelligence. Why? Because again, man could not have thought of such a thing. Amen. This wisdom only could come from God. We are just vessels, and vessels for the building of the church through I had to put that word in there. What I'm saying, you're not all that. Through Jesus Christ, for he said he will build his church. Regardless of what pastor you hear say, this is my church. If it's his church, it's not God's church. The songwriter said, it's the church triumph, and it builds by the hand of the Lord. It is built by the power of God. So the apostle did what? Laid the foundation. But now we are to continue to construct. That's my job, to help to construct the framework. Building the church is a spiritual, beloved's work whose progress cannot be measured by natural means. Amen. It didn't start that way, and it can't finish that way. But we are to be faithful to whatever work that God has assigned to our hands. Only God can calculate. Amen. Only God can calculate the real significance of our faithfulness to perform his work on earth. He has placed the Great Commission in our hands. And it is dependent on us to complete the task, to go ye into all the world and compel men to come in, that his house may be filled. Then afterwards, give an account of our work. Yes, while God does not measure the success of his church by how much money that the church has. Nowadays, the church, everything about the church is about money. Nor by what type of people that we have in our congregation. We got third-class citizens. We got teachers and doctors. That's not the way God measures the church. We got politicians, or by the square footage of the building that we call the church. God bases the success of the church, amen, by a yardstick of his own called obedience and faithfulness. Amen. That's his yardstick. Obedience, and obedience is better than sacrifice. His yardstick of obedience and faithfulness. Let's go to 1 Corinthians. All right. We don't have much time left. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 4 and 2. It said, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. If you a church steward, you are working in a church, you're not going to be faithful. Why you waste your time? 2 Corinthians 2 and 9. For to this end also did I write, that I might know the proof of you, whether ye be obedient in all things. Beloveds, God does not expect each of us to produce the same amount. Amen. But he does expect us to produce. Some of us, we are not productive. When it comes to kingdom work, we are not productive. But God expects us to be productive. He knows what we will be. He knows what we can be. But we must first be found faithful in the work of the church. Amen. Abraham sent in Elijah, his servant, to find a bride for Isaac. Y'all remember Rebecca. The servant is actually, became the apostle of the household of Abraham, Rebecca. The work of this apostolic church is centered in the bride of Christ. The bride of Christ will claim in that day his church, you and I. So then Abraham sent, listen to this part, I want y'all to get this. Abraham sent his servants out. The apostles also were sent out by who? Jesus Christ. We too must be ready to be sent out as individual apostles. Amen. The work must go on. In John 17 and 25, O righteous Father, the word have not known thee, but I have known thee, and thee have known, amen, that thou hast sent me. Jesus' work was not to build a kingdom all to itself. Although a lot of us in the church now, we try to build separate kingdoms. Amen. But to speak and do those things the Father taught him. Just as Jesus was willing to surrender his own will to do the will, amen, of the one who sent him, which was his Father, each and every baptized, Holy Ghost-filled believer must lose himself in the message and mission of Jesus Christ. All right? As we close, I said as we close, so y'all can start getting ready for Holy Communion. As we close, Colossians. We're going to close on this. Colossians 3 and 3. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Beloved, Jesus taught his disciples they could not accomplish his work, not without his spirit. Jesus told them to expect power when they receive what? The Holy Ghost. We want power, but we don't want the Holy Ghost. We don't want to even live holy. And not to attempt to do this work without it. Not without the Holy Ghost. We cannot be successful in building the kingdom without the Holy Ghost. This apostolic ministry is only possible, beloveds, when we are endowed with the power from on high. By what? The Holy Ghost. You may be elegant. You may be intellectual. And if you want to call it the Holy Spirit, that's fine with me. But you must be endowed with power on high by the Holy Ghost. We too, like the apostles of old. So in other words, if I said old, there must be some new apostles. We have a mission. We have a message. And that message is what? Go, preach, teach, and baptize. God bless you. Amen. Go, preach, teach, and baptize. So that ends our lesson on the apostolic church. So every church, if it follows the New Testament instructions, and giftings, amen, is an apostolic church. Let us prepare to partake of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Let us prepare. All right. Okay. All right.
Thank God for And so many open doors are
at my feet. Let us come together. If you have family members, bring your family members together with your grape juice or fruit juice, with your cracker, with your bread, as we get ready to partake of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ, on that night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had supped, he gave thanks. He broke it, and he said, "This is my body that is broken for you. As oft as you do it, you do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup. Also, after supping, and said, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. As oft as you do this, you do show forth my death, burial, and resurrection until I come again. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. This is the body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, which was broken for you. Take ye and eat all of it." The cup. This is the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, which is shed for many. As oft as ye drink it, you do show forth his death, burial, and resurrection till he come again. The blood of Jesus, take ye and drink all of it. After the supper, they went out into a mountain of olives. We don't have a mountain of olives to go to, but let us fellowship one with the other. God bless you, and may God forever smile upon you.